Good morning and welcome to Bethel United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Ted. Let's listen to the word for a moment here to get our hearts settled. Psalm 19, one of my favorites, reads, "The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display his craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make him known. They speak without a sound or word. Their voice is never heard. Yet their message has gone throughout the earth, and their words to all the world. God has made a home in the heavens for the sun. It bursts forth like a radiant bridegroom after his wedding. It rejoices like a great athlete eager to run the race. The sun rises at one end of the heavens and follows its course to the other end. Nothing can hide from its heat. The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy to the heart." Anybody got joy this morning?
Amen.
Okay, good. Sorry, I got lost. "The commands of the Lord are clear, giving insight for living. Reverence for the Lord is pure, lasting forever. The laws of the Lord are true. Each one is fair. They are more desirable than gold, even the finest gold. They are sweeter than honey, even honey dripping from the comb. They are a warning to your servant, a great reward for those who obey him. How can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Cleanse me from these hidden faults. Keep your servant from deliberate sins. Don't let them control me. Then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer." Amen. So as we sing this morning, may the words of our heart and the meditations of our heart, words of our mouth, meditations of our heart, be pleasing to God, that we would sing for joy because of who he is. Sing to the King.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb who was slain. Life and salvation his empire shall bring. And joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song declaring that we belong to Jesus. He's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King.
For his returning.
For his returning, we watch and we pray. We will be ready the dawn of that day. We'll join in singing with all the redeemed. 'Cause Satan is vanquished and Jesus is King.
Come, let us sing a song.
Come, let us sing a song. A song declaring that we belong to Jesus, 'cause he's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King.
Lord, we lift our voices up to you, because you are worthy of all of our praise. Jesus, we thank you that you are the cornerstone laid for us, and our hope is built on nothing less.
Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing that again. My hope is built on nothing less.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
No one greater.
When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil.
Christ alone,
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. In the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
He's coming back.
When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then Him in be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.
Only Jesus can do that for us.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Just the voices.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Some years ago, this writer decided to fast from worshiping with music for a month because he felt like the worship in song was taking the place of worship of God. It was almost like there was a worship of song. So he wrote this song at the end of those 30 days as the Lord had drew him closer to Him, showing him that he could worship in many, 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 many ways. And so the first line of the song says, when the music fades and all is stripped away. That's the context of the song, just so you know.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart, and I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
He's the King of endless worth.
King of endless worth. No one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath,
I'll bring you more than a song.
I'll bring you more than a song. For a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper, you search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart.
Come back to Jesus.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
Yeah. Lord, it's so good to be loved by you. A songwriter wrote in the 60s, how sweet it is to be loved by you. And Lord, we know it's true for us. We're grateful for, Lord, for how you love us, how you've shown your love on the cross. Where would we be without you? You drew us to us. We drew us to you, Lord, by your kindness, by your grace. Oh, how he loves you and me. Let's sing this together.
Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life, what more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Jesus to Calvary did go, his love for sinners to show. What he did there brought hope from despair. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Last two lines.
Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Lord, we love you because you loved us first. And we come this morning to recognize you, your presence here, and all that you've done. We do pray, Lord, that the words of our mouth and meditations of our heart would be acceptable and pleasing to you. For you're worthy of all of our love. In Jesus' name, amen. Please take a seat.
Good morning. I'm Pastor John. Welcome to the Bethel United Methodist Church. We're so glad you came out to join us this morning. We also want to welcome all of you that are joining us on live stream. Thanks for tuning in this morning. It's always a pleasure and an honor to come into your homes. So before we started, I just wanted to share a little something that God put on my heart. You know, I was thinking that here we are in the middle of June. We're almost halfway through the year. It's hard to believe that 2022 is just racing by us. And it got me to thinking, I think God challenged me to say, are you any different 6 months into the year with your faith than you were in January? And I think it's a great question for all of us to take stock and think about that over these coming weeks. Are we any different? Have we gone deeper? Are we being bold and courageous for Jesus? Are we trying to serve our church so that we can reach the lost? Do we pray more? Do we spend more time in Scripture? Or are we the same as we were in January? And that's a great challenge for us. And that challenge, I know for me personally, was prompted with our service yesterday for Jim Berghoff. Jim Berghoff served the Lord always, constantly, never stopping, even through his sickness. Those people that spoke yesterday and all the people that I have talked to, his family, friends, Jim was a constant, constant representation of Jesus. A much taller white beard version, but he was a representation of Jesus. And he did it with kindness and consideration and constantly really trying to improve everyone's life who came in contact with him. That's Jesus. And that's a great challenge for us. We must be different in this world than everybody else. Amen. We need to shine. People need to see us and know that we are Christians, not here on Sunday mornings, but every day of the week. And anybody who knew Jim Berghoff, whether his work at CLNP or playing Santa or singing in this choir or walking through the neighborhood, they all knew Jim Berghoff loved Jesus. And that's a great challenge for us. That's a great challenge for us. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the life of Jim Berghoff, but we thank you for what he represented, and really his ministry lives on in all of us because of who he was and what he brought forth to the world. He brought Jesus, and he carried him around everywhere he went, everywhere. And in his own way, he made such a difference in this world. And I keep thinking of the word kindness. Kindness, because Jim was kind and he was considerate. And I loved hearing the story of how he would come to church with a pocket full of quarters and give quarters out for good report cards and even more money when you made the honor roll. Who does those things? Nobody, but Jim did. And it made an impact on generations. And so, Father, we thank you for Jim this morning. We just thank you for him. But we thank you for him being a role model for us. And I pray, Lord, that we are challenged this week. That we are not the same as we were in January or last year. That we would go deeper in our faith, that we would stop, putting it off. The world needs Jesus like never before. The world needs more Jim Berghoffs in the world, Lord. And so we can be that. We can be the hands and feet of Jesus. And so, Lord, I pray for an anointing over every one of us that's here today, those that are listening, that you would challenge us, Lord, that you would push us to not just be content saying we're a Christian, but to be out being a Christian, Lord. And it begins with me. And I accept that challenge from you today, Lord, and I pray that all of you do as well. And so, Father, be glorified in everything that we do here this morning. Everything, Father. Let it all be uplifting unto you and unto the name of Jesus, our wonderful, beautiful Savior. We thank you for Jesus, Lord, and we thank you for the time that we're together, and we ask, Lord, that you would just touch us in a new way this morning. And we ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, please stand as you're able for our first hymn, number 328, Surely the Presence of the Lord. You can find it in your blue hymnals, and the words will be up here on the screen for you.
Be seated. Now, during Jim's service yesterday, there were a lot of tears, but there were also a lot of laughs. And one of my favorites was hearing how Pastor John and Big Jim would go downstairs sometimes, and Big Jim would say, "That was a great sermon, Pastor. I should give you a quarter." And Pastor John had no idea what that meant until yesterday. That was fabulous. Few announcements for this morning. The flowers on the altar are available. If you would like them, please see Alice after the service. And of course, if you ever need flowers during the week or need an arrangement, she can hook you up with that as well. So Alice, wave your hand. Everybody knows who Alice is. Brotherhood and Sisterhood are meeting tomorrow night. Brotherhood will be downstairs at 7 o'clock in Mitchell Hall, and Sisterhood will be up in Wesley Lounge at 7 o'clock also. I understand that Brotherhood had an excellent service and fundraising opportunity yesterday at the car show. They were serving food and helping raise money for the Danbury Special Olympics team. It was well attended. I heard from a number of the men that they had a great time and that they served, quote, a ton of food, but they have no idea how much actually, and we're hoping that maybe we'll get an update from Victor when he gets back from Virginia on that.
And the ladies.
And the ladies, too. So thank you very much.
Mary Helen let me know that they would have never made it without the ladies. And
amen.
And I would tend to agree.
A couple upcoming items to put on your calendar. In July, on July 16th, Pastor Ted and a number of us are going to be participating in A Day in the Sun. That's S-O-N. It's going to be an opportunity to hear some live music and a little bit of praise and worship, maybe some testimony as well. That'll be at Dickinson Park on July 16th from 4 to 7. Bring some food, bring a camp chair, come and enjoy. They're also going to be collecting non-perishable food for a local food pantry. I'm sure we'll have more information on that coming up as it gets closer, but wanted to get it on your radar because the summer does get busy. Also, recently we had the Footsteps in the Sand Men's and Women's Weekends. I heard both of them were amazing, and they will be having a second set of weekends in the late fall. Last weekend of October, the 28th through 30th, and November 11th through 13th will be the Women's and Men's Weekends, or they may be the Men's and Women's Weekends. They haven't set which is which yet. But if you'd be interested in participating in that, Put it on your calendar, and we'll have more information on that as we get closer. If you would all please rise for the call to worship, let us worship God together. Welcome to worship today. We are glad to be here. Open your eyes and your hearts to God's Spirit. We open our lives to God's Word. Rejoice, for God is with us this day. Thanks be to God for God's loving presence. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. So this is our time of pastoral prayer, where I share the joys and concerns that Pastor Ted and I have received this past week. We also carry over some of the more serious joys, especially concerns, so you may hear some repeated. So again, the best way to get these to us is through our prayer portal, because when they come in, then I can take them and forward them to other pastors, and the prayers will begin immediately. As I share these joys and concerns, again, my hope is that you will hear one, and the Lord will touch your heart, and that you will adopt that person or that situation for the coming week. We'll then have a moment of silence where you can lift your joys and concerns unto the Lord in the quietness of the church or in your homes. And then I'll provide a covering prayer, and we'll close in the Lord's Prayer. So we are continuing to pray for Audrey, who is in the hospital. She is really starting to fight for her life, so we pray for Audrey. We continue to pray for Brian and his family in Colorado as he continues to battle cancer. We're praying for Suzanne McCluskey, who's looking to find permanent career opportunity. We have joys and prayers for continued health for Dorothy Baird, who's celebrating her 75th birthday today. We want to just pray for all the unrest and now what seems to have infected every country, nuclear threats, wars. We pray for wisdom and protection for the United States Supreme Court. Of course, we are praying for those that are struggling, especially those with low incomes, with all the prices increasing, gas and food. We're praying for open doors to have conversations about faith in Jesus and for boldness and courage to speak the truth in love, which is what we discussed this morning about Jim. We continue to pray for Debbie, who has recently been admitted into the ICU. We're praying for all of those who are still suffering from COVID. We're thankful the numbers are beginning to turn down, but there are still a lot of people that are getting COVID. Of course, we pray for comfort for the family, the friends, and the community over Jim Berghoff's passing. We're lifting up the Nutting and the Rizzo family for peace this morning. We're lifting up Paul Daria, who fell and is in the hospital this morning. I wanted to tuck a prayer in for there's so many pastors moving in our conference, and many of them, today's their last day. Today's their last day preaching. So that's a difficult day for the pastors and a difficult day for the churches. So just if you could keep just the pastors in general in your prayers, especially those that are moving in the coming weeks. Of course, we want to continue to pray for peace in the Ukraine, and we continue to pray for our nation, for peace, and that we would find joy in the hearts of many, and pray for our leaders that they would turn their eyes to Jesus and not to each other. So I also want to tuck in one prayer. It's really a joy. I want to honor Colin Barnabo. Colin Barnabo is having his Eagle Court Scout of Honor today. He's becoming an Eagle Scout. And if you're not, you may hear of what that is. The commitment is massive. It's years. It's years of work. And I can tell you the Eagle Scouts rise up and become great leaders. And so praise God for this young man and for his family and his dad who has supported him through all of this. So I just want a round of applause for him this morning. I'll be honored to go there later and join them and offer a prayer, so praise God for that. So let's have a moment of silence, and you can lift your joys and concerns directly unto the Lord in the quietness of the church, and then we'll close in prayer. Lord, we thank you for Jesus this morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that because of Jesus, we have this time of pastoral prayer. We thank you that because of Jesus and his willingness to go and lay down his life for us, that, Father, we can have eternal life, and that we can pray for life to the full here on this earth. Lord, we say this a lot, but it's a great scripture. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. Father, we need to remember that when we see all these difficult things come into our spaces, Lord, when we find difficult things that come into our own personal lives, into our homes, into our families, into our communities, into our country, and into the world, Lord, we see evil everywhere. And we pray against it this morning, Lord. We pray against it. And Father, we thank you that Jesus is still in the healing business and the restoration business and the renewal business. And yes, he's still in the transformation business. And that's what we pray for all of us today, that we would find a way to seek and spend the time to be transformed, to let you speak to us. Father, to challenge us, because we've been called by you, Lord, to make a difference in the world and not just sit back and complain about it. And so, Father, we lift up every joy, and we thank you for all those joys. We lift up every concern, and we plead the blood of Jesus over all of them, Lord. And we pray for your perfect will in all situations, Lord, even when we don't understand the outcomes, Father. Lord, we know there's many times things happen and we ask why. And that's okay. As long as we're praying and we're having a conversation with you, we can ask why. And we may not get the answer, but Father, we'll find peace. And we find a way to trust in you when we don't understand what's going on. And so, Father, we thank you for your kindness, your mighty power, your provision. And of course, we thank you for Jesus, our Savior. And so now let's close in the prayer that Jesus himself taught the disciples by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, we pause now to allow you to bring your tithes and gifts and offerings unto the Lord as the Spirit moves you. I'd ask the usher team to prepare the collection plates, but let's have a word of prayer over our offering. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your mighty supernatural provision in our lives, Lord. We thank you that you care for us in so many ways. And Father, the word tells us that it is an honor and a privilege to bring a portion of that back into the storehouse of the Lord. And so, Father, we lift up every tithe, gift, and offering unto you. We ask that you would bless it, the hands that gave it, and let it help us to continue to do the mission you've called us to do here in Bethel. And we ask for this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. That was beautiful. Let's turn to our attention to the Word of God. This is Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2, and then 12 through 17 from the Message version. Colossians 3. He is your life. So, if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. See things from His perspective. So, chosen by God for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God picked out for you. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. Be even-tempered, content with second place, quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you. And regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it. Let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Give it plenty of room in your lives. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense. And sing. Sing your hearts out to God. Let every detail in your lives, words, actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master, Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. The Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Hard not to read that scripture and not think of Big Jim. Amen. Wow. I just saw him all over that scripture this morning. Well, please stand as you're able for our hymn of preparation, Step by Step. The words will be up on the screen.
Let's take a moment to offer each other a sign of peace. The peace of the Lord be with you. Peace. Let's pray before the message this morning. Father, thank you so much for choosing us to be your children. Thank you for providing a way through Jesus and the blood that he shed. Thank you, Lord, for Holy Spirit, who is with us every moment of the day and lives within us, not outside of us. We hear the scripture this morning, Lord, and we're inspired to live a life that honors you and pleases you. Yet, Lord, we know that apart from you, we can't do it. So we ask for your help in every piece of what was read this morning, Lord, and every purpose and will that you have for us. Lord, we pray that your kingdom come and that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And you've made us citizens of the kingdom. So, Lord, we look to cooperate with you in what your will is and what it is that you want done. We think about so many, Lord, who are sick and suffering, who don't know you, who do know you, Lord, and how you've given us this realm of influence of people that we can love with your love. And so we ask you, Lord, to wake us up this morning to you and to what you're saying. We thank you so much for Pastor John and for the way that he loves you and strives to be more like you. Even hearing this morning, Lord, about what you said to him about, okay, the year's halfway done. Have you grown deeper in faith? There's a heart that pleases you, Lord, one that seeks hard after you. May that be true of us, Lord. We pray, Lord, that as Pastor John delivers this message, that we would have ears that are wide open, eyes that are wide open, hearts that are wide open, and that we'd be willing to be conformed to the image of Jesus, to be changed, to be more like him. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Ted. Before we start, I wanted to just offer my personal thanks to the choir and to Jess and Sarah for yesterday's amazing, amazing music that they gave at the service. I mean, they had to do extra practices and just complete dedication. And it was an emotional time for them because remember, that's where Jim was. They knew Jim. They worked with Jim, they sang with Jim, and so I just want to personally thank you. I don't know how you guys are pulling it off today. The songs are beautiful. I don't know where you're getting the energy. Praise God, but thank you for everything you do for us. Amen. Thank you. We're very blessed to have a wonderful choir. So today I want to talk about speak life and not corrosive talk. Speak life. I'm sure you've noticed, as I certainly have, and we've talked about it quite a bit, it seems like we can't make it through one day, without seeing or hearing something negative. It's just nonstop. It's an ongoing cycle that we hear of death, destruction, lies, grief, and just poisonous talk all around us. It is also easy for all of us to fall into the traps of what I'm calling corrosive talk today. The definition of corrosive is described as having the power to corrode. And corrode is another word for undermining, which means to weaken or destroy gradually. I think of corrosion in our vehicles. It's not like it used to be. You used to ride down the road and see rust buckets everywhere. But because so many of the cars are made of plastic, it's not as prevalent as it used to be. But corrosion, we know what corrosion does. Corrosion will make things weak, and it'll happen gradually, most of the time, without us even knowing it. All of a sudden, we may notice, like under our door panels or around the fender wells, that we suddenly have rust or corrosion. And it certainly does tend to sneak up on us by the time we realize it and the damage has already been done. The best way to know if your car's got corrosion is wash it by hand. You'll be shocked. And so it is with corrosive talk. I think this is a sad state that we are calling life because we are becoming numb. We are really becoming numb to the terrible things that are going on all around us. And God put on my heart this week that much of what comes out of our mouths has become corrosive talk, and we don't even realize it. You see, we must remember that words are not simply caused by our mouths shaping air that is passing through our larynx. Words have real power, real power. Think about how this entire world began. Scripture tells us that God spoke. He spoke the world into existence by the power of his words. We also know from Scripture that we, as the children of God, were created in God's image. And that means that our words have power as well. It does not mean that our words have the power to manifest reality as God did, but let's face it, our words certainly do more than just convey information. Our words have impact on people all around us. We see the power of words displayed out in front of us pretty much every single day. The power of our words can stir up hatred and violence. Words can create deep wounds or reopen ones from the past. These type of words certainly would fall into the category of corrosive. And the title of our message today is called Speak Life. Speak life, not corrosive talk. You see, God's desire for all of us is to learn how to control what comes out of our mouth, so that when we do bring forth words, they speak life. Many times, corrosive words come in the form of complaining or whining or criticizing. I remember hearing a story of a man who had just decided he was kind of fed up with life, and he thought it would be a great idea to go and join a monastery to get away from the rest of the world. Well, this monastery was very strict, and one of the rules of this particular group was that you were not allowed to speak, which is common. And this one said you can only speak two words at the end of every month. So at the end of the first month, he was brought before the elders of this monastery and given an opportunity to speak his words. And he said, "Food bad." At the end of the next month, he was once again brought forth and he shared the next two words. He said, "Bed hard." At the end of the following month, he once again came before the board and they asked him, "What two words would you like to share with us today?" And he replied, "I quit." The monk in charge responded, "Well, it doesn't surprise me a bit. You've been nothing but whine and complain ever since you got here." But I think you've probably met, and I've met people who kind of have done nothing but complain ever since they got here. I don't mean here in church, I mean here in life. Nothing but complain ever since they got here. Again, corrosive words tend to sneak up on us without us even realizing it. I think for the most part, many Christians try to tell the truth. We try not to gossip. We try not to talk ill of other people. We try not to use cuss words, well, some of us do, or at least not use God's name in vain. But many, many pay very little attention to the corrosive words of complaining and criticizing that can flow so easily out of our mouths. Now, you may disagree with me that complaining and criticizing could be considered corrosive words. Most corrosives come in the form of some sort of acid, and they will work in different ways. But in the end, they all have the same mode of operation, burning or eating through whatever they come in contact with. And honestly, that's what corrosive words do to whatever they touch. Corrosive words have the power to destroy our spiritual life and most certainly destroy our human relationships. When we give ourselves over to complaining and criticizing and not having the ability to see some good in our situations of life around us, then we are creating a formula that will destroy, literally destroy, our relationship with others, and our relationship with God the Father. Giving ourselves over to complaining comes much easier than you think. You know, people have no issues complaining about the weather, our local, state, federal government. People have no problem complaining about the economy, about their jobs, their bosses, their coworkers, or about how much money they take home every week. That's common conversations these days. People find it very easy to complain about their physical features, whether there's too much here, too little here, whatever that might be, they'll complain all about it. I know people that will complain, these are Christians, that will complain about their parents, their children, their siblings, and yes, they will even complain in public about their spouse or significant others. When did that come okay? When it comes to complaining, or should I say corrosive talk today, my friends, nothing's off the table. Nothing is sacred. And do we really think that complaining is going to change anything? And then we come to the corrosive talk of criticizing. You know, I remember my parents thought that criticizing was a good way to expand our education. And most people that grew up in the 40s, 50s, 60s, it kind of was a normal household thing. You know it. Stop chewing so loud. Stop slamming that door when you come in or out. Stop forgetting your homework at school. Is there a brain in that head of yours? How many heard that from their parents? Amen. Sit up straight. Wash your face. My mother's favorite. Are you trying to grow potatoes in those ears of yours? Heard that constantly. Now, I can chuckle about most of these today, but honestly, that's not a pretty picture that we want to have in our homes. It's a home filled with corrosive talk. Corrosive speech comes in many different sizes, shapes, and forms, and they all have a variety of roots of where they begin. It can come from anger that keeps building up instead of one, and it needs some way to come out. It can come from irritations and uncertainty produced by all the things that are swirling all around us. It can come from disappointments when things don't go as we had expected, or when people don't treat us in the way that we had hoped for. So what does the Bible say about corrosive speech in the form of complaining and criticizing? King Solomon is known to be the author of the book of Proverbs. This book is filled with many one or two sentences that can guide us in life. David, I don't know, do I have an overhead for this one? The next, I don't remember. Nope, go back. Let me read Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 to you. The tongue has the power of life. The tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. That's simple. Are we using our words to build people up, or do we use them to undermine and destroy them and try to advance our cause? I think it's important, my friends, that we begin to take stock as believers, as followers of Christ, as ambassadors of Jesus, of what is coming out of our mouths. Are our words filled with blessings or bitterness? Are they filled with hate or love? Do we speak of victory, or are we constantly talking in a mindset of defeat? It is important to know that the words that we speak here on our time on earth, we will have to give an account for. This is interesting. Everything we say, our entire lives, we will have to give an account for. All will be revealed when we stand before our Savior Jesus in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, verses 36 to 37. This, I know, is a slide. But I tell you that men and women, of course, will have to give account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. Not some, every. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. That's from Jesus himself. I believe as followers of Christ, we must be doing all that we can so that our speech is to be characterized by only what is helpful for building others up, as spoken of in our scripture reading today. Jesus also reminds us in the book of Matthew that the words we speak are actually the overflow of our hearts. When we have accepted Christ, my friends, there is an expectancy that a change of speech follows, because living for Christ makes a difference. It should make a difference in the choice of words that we use. If we are to call ourselves Christians and want to impact the world for Jesus, then we must have hearts that have been changed by the power of God, a change reflected in our words. I have to admit, I'm going to say it, I am not happy about spending close to $5 a gallon in gasoline. I'm not. I can't believe it. Last weekend, I filled up my truck, I filled up a couple gas cans for my lawn equipment, and I almost fell over when I saw the total of $137. And gas has gone up another 11, 12 cents since Saturday. But I've made a decision. I made a decision because I could feel my corrosive talk coming every time I went to get gas. I made a decision that I could either speak corrosive talk, like complaining about that price to everybody that I came in contact with, and complain about our government, and complain about the world events that seem to be raising the cost of fuel and everything else. I can do that easy. But instead, I decided I wanted to speak life, even in the middle of this terrible crisis that we're going through. You know, I'm grateful. I'm really grateful that I have a nice truck to put gas into. I'm grateful for that. I love my truck. I love it. I'm grateful to the Lord for my home and this piece of property that I have that gives me great privacy. And we love it there. And yes, it needs to be mowed, but I enjoy doing that. I'm grateful for that. Can you see how a small shift in our attitudes and our words can really make a difference? Our words should demonstrate the power of God's grace in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So how can we keep our hearts from developing a complaining and critical spirit so that our mouths speak life and not corrosive words? My friends, because we live in an imperfect world with imperfect people all around us, including ourselves, then we must expect that things and people are not going to go the way or behave in a manner that we want them to. I can assure you, there are always going to be opportunities to complain and criticize and allow corrosive words to come from our mouths. I realized many years ago that my expectations were not realistic. My expectations, especially of other people, quite frankly, it was way too high. I had set the bar so high about people around me. So I was constantly setting myself up for disappointment. And maybe you're doing that today. If we expect that people are always going to do the right thing, always, and they're always going to do what's best for us, then sadly, we are in for a rude awakening. If we expect that life is always going to be easy, and we're never going to face challenges, and we're never going to deal with difficult times, then we are really going to struggle when things don't go our way because of our unrealistic expectations. They're unrealistic. And the easiest way for us to change our mindset and not have high expectations of life and people in our lives is this: an attitude of gratitude. There it is. It's that simple. It's not about what other people say. It's not about what other people do. What are you grateful for? What are you grateful to the Lord for in your life? We need to start thanking God every day for the things that we do have and not complain about the things we don't. Amen? Just as we find something to complain about, trust me, we can always find something for which we are grateful about. Always. We just take those things for granted. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18 says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus." This is what God wants. This is what God expects from us. Stop looking at what's missing and look at what the Lord has blessed you with. This is how we speak life. We speak life. A heart of gratitude comes from a heart that loves God and is able to recognize all of the blessings that God has placed in one's life. I think corrosive speech happens when we develop spiritual amnesia. Spiritual amnesia. This is when we focus on all the negative things in life and we forget God's presence, God's deliverance, and God's provision. Spiritual amnesia has a very easy antidote, and that is to remember and learn to count our blessings and be grateful unto the Lord every single day. I do a lot of funerals, and it always grieves me that people suddenly appreciate the one who is gone at the funeral. Why didn't I? Why didn't I say this? Why didn't I just accept them for who they were? Why was I so hard on them? Why was I so critical? I hear this all the time. And that is a ball and chain that is hard to get rid of. We need to be grateful. So I pray that you begin to really think about the words that are coming out of your mouth. People want to be around positive people, right? We don't want to be around people that complain. I know the price of gas is high. You don't need to remind me. We need to pray about our words and what we say, not only to others, but this is the last piece I'll say to you. But what words are running through your own mind? Because you speak to yourself. We speak to ourselves all day long. Some of us like to talk to ourselves out loud, and that's okay too. But we speak to ourselves in our minds. What words are you putting into your thoughts? Are they corrosive or are they speaking life? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. It's so easy for us, Lord, to shift to the negative. It's so easy for us to just complain. Oh, I wish this would happen. Oh, why can't that happen? Oh, I wish I had that. I want that. Nothing ever happens for me. Nothing goes my way. That's corrosive talk. And we're poisoning ourselves, not only those around us. And so, Lord, I pray if we have the attitude of gratitude when we wake up each day, thank the Lord that he breathed life into you, that he allowed you to see another sunrise. What a way to start our day. Thank you, Lord. You gave me another day. And we pray that, Lord, use me today. Father, thank you. Your will, not mine. Lord, can do something with that. That's pliable clay. And Lord can mold and shape us when we're pliable, when we're ready to be stretched and pulled and challenged. It's beautiful. And God can make something wonderful out of that. But if we're hard and we're like granite, there's not much God can do with that because we're not letting him. It's not because he doesn't want to. So trust me, today, Lord has something great for you. The Lord wants to use you in new and exciting ways that you haven't even thought about. But we got to be ready, and we got to be pliable, and we got to be open, and we have to speak life. And so, Lord, help us. let us be known for our enthusiasm. Let us be known. I love hanging around that person because they're always upbeat. And then they'll ask you why. They'll ask you why. Why are you so positive all the time? And you can say, because of Jesus. We can't take credit for it. Because of Jesus, we have joy. It's not happiness, it's joy. Because it comes from within. And it comes from our Savior Jesus. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for that love. We thank you for this reminder of how much you love us. Lord, remind us every day that we should have an attitude of gratitude. And we ask for this in Jesus' mighty name, and all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen.
Let's stand together and sing Nothing But the Blood, verses 1 and 2.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Give thanks. Those are my two words. The Lord bless you, and let's meet downstairs in fellowship and build each other up, all right? God bless you.